Introduction. The Islamic economic system is the collection of rules, values, and standards of conduct that organize economic life and establish relation of production in an Islamic society. These rules and standards are based on the Islamic order as recognized in the Quran and Sunnah and the corpus of jurisprudence opus, which was developed over the last 1,400 years by thousands of jurists. Responding to the changing circumstances and evolving life of Muslims all over the world, Islamic economy has been having a revival over the last few decades. Many scholars trace the history of economic thought through the Muslim world, which was in a golden age from the 8th to 13th century, and whose philosophy continued the work of the Greek and Hellenistic thinkers and came to influence Aquinas when Europe rediscovered Greek philosophy through Arabic translation.
My name is Ahmad Awliya Amin bin Muhammad Yazid. My metric number is 269972. And today I want to talk about the biography of Dr. Muhammad Nejatullah Siddiqui and his contribution to the Islamic economic thought. First, we go to the biography of Dr. Muhammad Nejatullah Siddiqui. Muhammad Nejatullah Siddiqui may be a world-renowned Islamic economist and is that the winner of the King Faisal International Prize for Islamic Studies. He was born in Gorakhpur in 1931. He earned PhD economist at Aligarh Muslim University and got religious training in Sharia studies from Dar-e-Gah Islami and Jamiatul Islam. He served as associated professor of economy and professor of Islamic studies at the Aligarh Muslim University and as professor of economy at the King Abdul Aziz University, Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, and its Center for Near Eastern Studies at the University of California, Los Angeles, and at that time a visiting scholar at the Islamic Research and Training Institute, Islamic Development Bank, Jeddah. He has served on numerous committees and participated in many conferences in various parts of the globe. He is very helpful for all and shares invaluable knowledge within the society. Presently, he lives in Aligarh, India. Last, he is Professor Emeritus within the Department of Management Studies in Aligarh, India. Next, we go to the Muhammad Nejatullah Siddiqui contribution to the Islamic economic thought. First point is end of economic enterprise. In his research, Dr. Nejatullah Siddiqui states that Islam is mainly concerned with a push towards the economic activities. It condemns the materialistic approach. In most of terms, this principle directly relates the economic policies with the moral values. Next, consistent with Nejatullah Siddiqui, an individual who fit himself well, wears decent clothes and supplies himself with cardinal comfort with a view to creating himself more efficient, more useful within the service of the great, is welcome to the society of Islam. Economic goods and properties that are consumed and possessed as mean to the upper end are all desirable. Last, Nejatullah states that no religious duty is recognized as assaulted because the duty of striving and of welfare. The next key point is justice and benevolence as the basis of interpersonal entrepreneurial behavior. According to Nejatullah Siddiqui, the character of Islamic system starts with some basic values which are themselves the reflection of the Islamic norms of goodness and well-being, and seeks to create the whole life activity a realism of these values. Nejatullah also explained that justice can give us a way of proportion to act reasonably in any circumstance. This approach has important bearing upon the entrepreneurial behavior in that far because it affects competition, monopolistic practice, and other behaviors of the contemporary firms. Last, Nejatullah Siddiqui emphasize that Islam as a principle requires fair dealing with the article of trade clearly determined, so as both the parties to the transaction is also able to weigh their advantage. Lack of full knowledge about the particulars of the transaction may be a source of doubt and uncertainty and destroy the fair nature of the dealing. Thank you.
Point number 3. The market under the influence of the Islamic spirit. Nejatullah Siddiqui observed that Islam does not propose to suppress the market mechanisms completely, neither does it regard the working of this mechanism as a sure method to bring about the desirable results. Unlike capitalism, it poses clearly defined norms for economic activity. Islam requires a particular type of behavior from the economic agent, the consumer, and the producers. Economic rationality assumes the consumers to be aiming at maximization of their satisfaction. Under the influence of Islamic spirit, a rational Islamic individual would order this behavior with a view to achieving maximal conformity with the Islamic norms. Nejatullah Siddiqui said that under the influence of Islamic spirit, following things will have important bearing upon the pattern of demand in an Islamic economy, such as the demand for alcoholic drink and other prohibited goods and services would fall to zero. The trend of the luxury goods to multiply would be checked, and their demand as a whole would decrease. Certain luxury goods may even go out of demand. The demand for necessity and some of comfort will increase, other things being the same, due to the more equitable distribution of wealth and income. Also, social needs like defense, education would be reflected in the demand in the form of a decrease in the demand for luxuries and an increase in the demand for services and goods associated with these social needs. And last, the demand for cultural services and leisure will increase adversely affecting the demand for material comfort and luxuries of life. Point number 4 is Muslim entrepreneur and the economy. A Muslim entrepreneur seeks to earn a decent living through business enterprise and also the serve society through his business. In deciding which industry to enter, where to locate the firm, and on what scale to organize production and similar order issues. He will, within limits set by his financial resources and entrepreneurial abilities, and strive to keep both these ends in view.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Shazir Aiman bin Ramli, number matric 270067. I will present about an Islamic economic scholar, which is Syed Muhammad Baqir Assad. So, Syed Muhammad Baqir Assad was born at 1st March 1934 at Iraq, and then he died on 9 April 1980 when he was 25 years old. So, he was a scholar, philosopher and ideological founder of Islamic Dawah Party at in Kazimia, Iraq. And then he came from the religious family, but at the same time he also came the Shia cleric. For example, his father Haidar Assad. Okay, we look at his offspring. His father Haidar Assad is one of the well-respected high ranking of Shia cleric. So it doesn't matter how we came, either Shia or anything, but his knowledge about economic of Islamic economic doctrine is more important to us, and we will thanks to Syed Muhammad Baqir because he is one of the scholar that did own doctrine about Islamic economy. So this is a education background of Syed Muhammad Baqir. When he was 12 years old, he studying a book about Ma'alim al-Usul under his brother Syed Ismail al-Sadr. And then at the same time, he complete his religious education at religious seminaries, and then he emerged as a profile writer and wrote 26 books. He wrote 26 books about jurisprudence, philosophy, logic, history, theology, and also Islamic culture and economics. So, Syed Muhammad Baqir very master about Islamic culture and economics. And then, some of the books originally in Arabic have been translated into Persian, English, Urdu, and Turkish language. So, he's so powerful, he can translate in any language to give the understand to the Islamic people at that time. And then he involved an action of Iraq liberation because at the moment the British came to Iraq and want to conquer about economy and the politics at Iraq. So, this is the storyline and economic scholar, which is Syed Muhammad Baqir Assad did about economic scholar. He wrote a book on economics, namely Iqtisaduna. Iqtisaduna actually in Arabic, so the translate in English is economics. So inside the book, he critiques the economic doctrine that from the West doctrine is capitalism and socialism, and then he tried to change the perception from capitalism and socialism to the Islamic economics doctrine. And then he bring the Islamic economic doctrine, and then he shared to all of the Muslim at Iraq for that time. So this is the kind of book that he wrote, which is Iqtisaduna Al-Bank Al-Ribawi Fil Islam, Usury Free Banking in Islam, and Maqala Iqtisadiya Essay in Economy. This is the book that he wrote, and then he tried to give to ensure that all of the Muslim people understand about how the benefit and how important the Islamic economic. So this is a contribution, I think, contribution of Syed Muhammad Baqir about economy, the general structure of an economic, he discovery about Islamic economy and write the article, and then he create a own methodology about Islamic economy. So that's all for me. Thank you.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Muhammad Afran Fikri bin Syafi'i, 271496. Today I'm going to present about contribution of Muhammad Baqir Al-Sirat in terms of knowledge or theory in economic framework. The first contribution is he makes a general structure of Islamic economy. It is called Arkan Ar-Razia, refers to his book that is Iqtisaduna. There are three of general structure of Islamic economy. First is Mabda Al-Milkiyah Al-Muzdawijah, or it's called dual form or multiple of ownership. Second is Mabda Al-Huriyah Al-Iqtisadiyah Fi Nitaqin Mahdud. It means judicious economic freedom. And second and third is Mabda Al-Adalah Al-Ijtama'iyah. It means social justice. The second contribution is he makes an argument about historical materialism. The scientific aspect of Marxist economy is the historical materialism, while it is doctrinal aspect comprised of socialism and communism. The labor theory of Marx has also many loopholes. It does not apply in case of hoarding and in some technical and monumental production, as well as when there are fluctuations in the supply and demand. He strongly believes that no science of Islamic economics could be established in the absence of a doctrine of Islamic economics. The third contribution is he makes the process of discovery of Islamic economy, which is called Al-Amaliya Iktishaf Al-Mazhab Al-Iqtishadi. In the discovery process, all economic laws and rules, together with a large number of related concepts with economic and society, studied together and then used to find economic doctrines. In other words, if law has been gathered the foundation of legal doctrine, the law can also be found in the source of Islam. The last contribution is he makes a methodology of Islamic economy. Al-Asadr does not prefer the scientific method to be the methodology of Islamic economics, since such an approach to Islamic economics is not appropriate and inadequate to the nature of Islamic economics, which is a doctrine that seeks to construct the general principles and rules of Islam regarding human economic life on the primary source of knowledge in Islam. There are many scholars stress the history of economic truth of the Muslim world, such as Muhammad Najatullah Siddiqui and Muhammad Baqir Al-Sirat. Muhammad Najatullah Siddiqui, he served as associate professor of economic and professor of Islamic studies at the Aligarh Muslim University. There are four contributions of Muhammad Najatullah Siddiqui. They are, he makes the end of economic enterprise, second, justice and benevolence as the basis of entrepreneurial behavior. The third is he makes the market under the influence of the Islamic spirit. And the last, he states that a Muslim entrepreneur and the economy seeks to earn a decent living through business enterprise, also to serve the society through his business. Next is Muhammad Baqir Al-Sirat was a scholar, a philosopher and ideological founder of Islamic Dawah Party, or Hizbul Da'wah at Islamiyah in Al-Kazimiyah, Iraq. There are four contributions of Muhammad Baqir Al-Sirat. First is he makes a general structure of Islamic economics. Second, he makes an argument about historical materialism. The third, he makes the process of discovery of Islamic economic. And lastly, he makes methodology of Islamic economics. In conclusion, we must appreciate the contribution of our scholars to trace the history of economic thought through the Muslim world by examining books of economic philosophy, listening to talks on Islamic economics, and turning them into reference for solving economic problems. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. That's all from us. Thank you.